Getting up because it was just that I read Kuczynski wrong when I was talking to you guys. So I thought that he had a C dot EB, his action. He actually has a C EB dot, which is what we had. So there was no confusion to clear up. Okay, so our discussion for the point particle last class was accurate. I just, looking at it just now, in class with that problem. Fine. Okay, so. Now, in today's class, we're going to go on. Now, we're going to generalize our discussion of this point particle of the point particle to the string. Okay, the discussion proceeds basically in exact analogy to the discussion we had for the particle, and I'm just going to give you the final answer for the BRST transformation laws from which we will act. We will deduce a current, and we'll look at the answer and see whether it's reasonable. Okay. So the answer. I'm going to give you a final answer by which I mean I'm not going to go through the intermediate step of introducing the metric and the Lagrange multiplier and integrating out. Just the facts. Okay. So first we have to say what dx mu is. So remember, dx mu changes under the gauge transformation. The gauge transformation question here are different physics. C is the diffeomorphism field. So how does it change? Well, there's an I times epsilon, which is the anticommuting parameter, plus C times del plus C bar times del bar. Okay. The change of the scalar field under diffeomorphism. Okay. Now, what about the change of B? Now, you remember that in our general discussion, the change of B was proportional to the Lagrange multiplier. But remember, the Lagrange multiplier is what multiplies the metric. Okay? And we solve for B by the equation of motion from the metric. So, when you differentiate with respect to the metric, you get two terms. You get B, and you get whatever else you get. But whatever else you get is by definition the stress tensor, or the theory. Okay, so the solution to B is to set it equal to the stress tensor. Okay, so this just gives us a stress tensor, which we divide up into two parts. For convenience, the part that comes from the matter fields, X mu fields, and the part that comes from the BC forces. So Tm is the contribution of the stress tensor from the matter fields, Tg is the contribution of the stress tensor from the BC forces. Okay. And what about C? What about change in C? Well, last time, remember, we had C times C dot. There's an obvious extent. The obvious extension of that is this. And now let me check that I've got all this out. There was no half because there was a half in F, but then F had two terms. Cancel half. There's a half and then you write the formula term of S, but when you evaluate it, it has two terms. Okay, great. So this is accurate. Okay. Now, so we've got this symmetric transformation, which you can check if you'd like to directly by, it's a symmetry of the theory. But we'll do it a little more sophisticated. You see, we know that our theory is a conformal field theory. Okay? And I should, of course, say, by the way, that there are analogous rules for dB bar and dC bar. Right? You just replace this by T bar and TG bar, and this thing by C bar. Right. I'm not writing it down. It's the opposite. Okay? So now, the question I'd like to ask is the following. Can I write down... So let's suppose that I do the usual thing. So I try to write down BRST transformation charge as 1 by 2 pi I times dz of jz minus dz bar of jz bar. Let's call it j and j tilde b for BRST. So I'm playing the usual game. I try to write down, there's a charge and it's an integral over a current. And I'm going to try this. I'm going to make the assumption to start with that we have an analytic current you know, that JB is analytic, JB bar is acting analytic. And we'll see if that's correct with the answer. Okay? So the question I'm going to ask is, what is, can we write down, can we look at these transformation properties and write down JB and JB? Okay, so let's look at the transformation properties one by one. The first thing we want is that the change in X mu is that is just the derivative of X mu. So let's do the analytic part first. We only want to generate this part. Okay? So the change in X mu is the derivative of X mu times the sea feet. But we know that we know that on general grounds that the change in a field is obtained by looking at the pole, the residue of the pole between the generator in question and the field. We've derived this and used this many times. Okay? So we want some term in JB such that the product of this term and X mu has a pole which is C times del X. Okay? But we know what that is. It's C times the stress tensor. Because we know that the stress tensor acting on any function of the matter fields has a polar part which is derivative of that matter field. And that function of matter fields divided by pole. In particular, we know that it's true for X. For instance, for X, we can check explicitly. Very quickly, remember the stress tensor is proportional to del X del X. You add it on X. XX was a log. Del XX gives you the pole proportional to del X. The residue is proportional to del X.
Yeah, but we would also want a C bar.
We would also want a C bar. I'm just doing the analytic part. So that will come from G bar.
Oh, yes.
Okay? So I'm just trying to find the analytic part of this J piece. Great. So we've got one piece in the BRSD columns. It's C times T map. Okay. Now what? Now let's move on here. Whatever else we have shouldn't have any non-singular OP with matter fields. Because we've already got all the transformations of the matter fields from this part. So the simplest assumption to make is that all the remaining parts are functional of the coarse fields. Okay? So we want the coarse fields to have this property. Okay. So now to get this to get this straight, let's remind ourselves what the coarse stress tensor was. You remember we worked this out in generality when we studied the BC system, and we worked out that in general it was Tg was equal to del B times C minus lambda times del of BC. In our situation, as we've discussed, lambda is equal to 2. Can somebody remind me why lambda was equal to 2? It's a simple way of saying lambda had to be equal to 2. So lambda equals 2 gives way 2 to B and minus 1 to C. Why is that the correct answer?
The Maxwell invariance if you look at the vertex operators, they have to be 1-1 in our. Or, we had to have one way for confirming the inference to be
this. You're saying the C insertion gives you weight minus 1. Yeah, the simplest thing to say is that in our derivation of what B was, remember B was something with two analytic indices at the bottom. And therefore, it weighed 2. Whereas C was something with one analytic index at the top, and therefore, it weighed 1. Remember, C was a vector field, B was a 2-tensor. That's the source of the minus 1. That's the basic source.
Can't we see that much in that C tilde times V? This was the vertex operator, which was equivalent to integral of V square.
Yes. So if it had to be consistent, this had to have greater minus 1. But you see, that's the consistency of the final answer. Where in logic did it come from? It came from this index. Right? You remember we wrote this action in terms of B with lower indices, C with upper indices, and saw that the action was explicitly Y invariant. So the weight under conformal transformations, which in general is a weight under diffeomorphisms plus Y transformations, was purely going on the diffeomorphism, which now is then just given by counting the next one. Yeah, that was our derivation for Laplace. Okay, fine. Anyway, so the closed system under consideration. I should have said, by the way, that this room is needed at 3:30, so it's going to be a brief class.
We should hurry.
But anyway, yeah. There's some chocolate, something. Okay. Okay. So the closed system in consideration have this stress tensor. So let's see. So what we want for B, for the change in B, is that del B is equal to, let's drop the I epsilon. So what we want for the pole, so we want JB times B to have pole, and I'm writing on just pole B's. We want that to be, so now let's simplify it. So this is del B C with a minus 1, minus 2 B del C. And we call the z and the 0, we want this and this here we got the z, so w. Right? And we want that from here we want that jb of z times c of that times c of w goes like C del C over Z. Okay. So now let's try to see if we can come up with a guess for a current that will do this. Okay? So let's write out the answer and check if it works. Okay. So consider the current B C del C. Okay, also this thing had to have, of course, the, it had to be plus here. Because there's this part of the teaching. Okay, now the plus TM is trivial, because we already have from the path that we added already to the post current, we've got a term that's C times D. So C times D is 1 over Z minus W, so the TM is automatic. Okay? So this part is automatic from what we already have. The new part is to give us this. Okay. So let's see. First let's see it roughly. We want the OP, this new term to have an OP. We want this new term to have an OP with the we want the new term to have an OP with B that has 1B and 1C. Okay? So clearly the new term has to have 2 C's and 1 B. Right? Because it's C and B that are non-trivial contraction. Okay? So we also want one derivative to be left behind. So okay, so it looks like a reasonable thing to start with. So now let's check. So let's check. So what we want to do is to look at B C del C at Z acting on B and W. So what does the OP look like? Well, so we have 2 possible contractions. We can have either this guy contracting or that guy contracting. Let's do this guy contracting. That has no minus sign. But it has 1 over Z minus W, the whole thing squared with a minus sign, because then differentiating produces a minus sign, times times BC and Z. Okay? Now what we are interested in is the pole, which goes like Z minus W, and we want the operator to be expressed at the point W. Okay? So we need to cancel 1, 0. So this gives us, so this, the contribution from this contraction, the first contraction, is equal to minus del of BC by Z. Right? By the direct factor. What about the contribution of the second contraction? Firstly, we have minus sign because the C goes through the del C. Okay? But then there's nothing else. It's B del C times 1 over Z minus sign. and there's the minus sign because the C is constant. Then see, so it's the sum of these two. So we add them up, and what do we get? We get minus B del C with a factor of 2 minus del BC. Which is exactly what we want. I added, this term is del of B times C. I added. Is this clear? Okay, so we, the second contract, first contraction was this, the second contraction was this, and so I think there's my size. So if we're keeping track just of the polar part, we've got exactly what we want. Is this clear? Okay, let's also check that this thing does the right thing with C. Okay, so what we want to check is that JB times C is equal to C del C divided by Z. This is a Z, this is a Z. Okay, so this one's very easy because we take B to the N that goes through two anti-commuting galleries and picks up no sign. Then B with C is 1 over Z. So what we get is JB with C is C del C over Z minus W. Exactly as we want. We've got the form of the current because we've got a current that has the right poles with everything. So that's a fine current. So a provisionally final answer is that JB is equal to C times TM plus BC del C. There's a fancy way of writing this in terms of C times the coast current. It's not very useful, certainly. I won't even say this. This is the... This is... Well, forget. This is the same thing as C times the coast... The coast stress tensor divided by 2. That's because the coast stress tensor has two terms. One which is C del B, the other is del... You know, B del C. There's a term that is C del B when multiplied by C is 0. So all that remains is a term that is B del C. And then, so that it's getting proportional to the coast stress tensor, the fact that happens to be half. But it's not very useful, sir. So okay, let me just write it out. It's TM plus TG, CTG by 2. No, it's not a very useful thing. Okay, now, as far as transformation properties go, as far as generating the right transformation properties go, there's nothing more to say. However, it turns out to be convenient to add a total derivative to this definition. Okay, because it's a total derivative, it doesn't affect the qBRXT charge. Again, because it's a total derivative, precisely for that reason, it never affects the pole terms in the OPE. Right, so let me write down first what the total derivative is. Okay. It doesn't affect the pole terms because any any singular OP between C and anything is already a pole. You take two derivatives of it, it becomes 1 over Z minus W cube. Okay, so this is the pole way of saying that it doesn't affect the total charge. Okay, so it doesn't, but adding total derivatives to, if you want a current that generates a particular cement, you can always add total derivatives to that current because it doesn't affect charge, therefore generates the same symmetry. However, it does affect things locally, and we've chosen this so that in the critical dimension, the coast current will become a primary operator. It turns out that without this term, that won't happen. Okay, so it's a convenient choice of additional total derivative. that affects nothing physical.
Okay, it requires some verification.
Okay, I'll give you the answer. I won't do the calculation in class. I'll give you the answer in a bit. Okay, great. So, at the moment, it's just some choice of ambiguity that we fixed in a particular way that we find. Okay, great. So, this is how we are the current. And now we can ask, is this current conserved? Is the current conserved? Well, the answer is obviously yes. Why is it obvious that it's that's conserved current? Somebody? So what's the current conservation equation? In analytic terms, what's the current conservation?
Delta G is...
Okay? So why is it obviously conserved?
Because holomorphic.
Because every field here is holomorphic. It's a product of holomorphic fields, therefore it's a holomorphic current. Okay? And therefore it's obviously conserved current. Okay. When you work out the same algebra for J bar, that's obviously an anti-holomorphic current. Okay. So without saying anything else, this is a conserved charge. It's very nice. It's a nice operator. But there are a few more things we want to ask about. The most important of these is the question of whether Q squared is zero. Okay. Now, how do you address it? Given a current, how do you address, if you know the currents of a charge, how do you compute? Q is an anti-commuting object, so the square of the operator says the anti-commutator of the operator with itself. So now, what calculation with currents can you do to compute an anti-commutator of two charges? Come, we've done this for the previous sort of algebra. Remember, we had. And what about the OP tells you the answer?
Okay, you look at the operator insertion and then you convert it to a residue later.
Very good. And then do you remember what the answer? What terms I think matter? It was just the pole, right? The residue of the pole.
Yes.
Okay? So the question of whether Q square is to zero or not is a question of whether there is a non-zero residue to the JBG pole. Okay? So there's a bunch of OPEs that we should calculate for this coast current. Okay? Now, we've done a lot of OPE calculations in class. All of this is pure algebra. I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to present a lot of answers for you and leave it for you to check these things. Okay? So let me read out a set of OPEs that we will sometime through this course find. The first one, we've done part of it. We've computed the pole parts, but it will at some point we will have all the singular terms. So let's look at JB times B. You remember we've already found that the pole part is 1 by Z. So this is at Z and let's say 0. Okay? Already found that the pole part was 1 by Tm plus Tg. 1 by Z. But there were more singular terms and others. Plus J G, the ghost current, by Z squared. Okay, can somebody tell me what the dimension of the left hand side is? What is the dimension of JB? somebody, what's the dimension of the first term? What is the dimension of any result?
Dimension
of space. It would have been true had, you know, had you had been energy.
Yes, it is an intuitive energy. But this is
what is the dimension of charge?
Zero.
So
the expression for charge in terms of current.
Is one.
Right. So the dimension of JB must be 1, 0, because integral dz JB gives you 0. Dz is dimension minus 1, 0. So it had to be dimension 1, 0. Okay. So we've got this analytic term that has dimension 1, 0. Let's confirm this explicitly. Count from this term and tell me that it's 1, 0. Somebody, what's dimension of B? Give me all that. B is what?
2.
2. C is what?
-1.
Del C is what?
C.
0. Good. Add them up. 1. What about C times Tn?
Tn is 2. C is 1.
C is 1. Okay, good. Fine. What are the dimensions of all terms on the right hand side? 1 by Z cube is dimension?
Cube is dimension 3.
Good. What about the cost curve? What dimension does it have? What is the cost card? Expression of
B into C, so minus 2 minus 1, 1.
1. 1 over Z square is dimension?
Is
2. 2. So 2 plus 1 is 3. Dimension 1 by Z is dimension 1. Stress tensor dimension 2, dimension 3. So this is the kind of thing you should become routine for. You see it on page. First thing you do is check it. Make basic sense that every term has the same dimension. Okay, let's do this one. What's the dimension of the right hand side?
Zero.
Zero, very good. Dimension here?
Zero. Zero.
Because del C is zero, C is minus 1, 1 by Z is 1. Okay. And so on. Okay, so this is actually a very easy derivative. And they take almost no work. And we've done most of the derivation. See, this part we've already derived. This part we've derived. The rest, or else any tensor made out of matter. It would take. Wait, could I have a volunteer to derive this open? I'm sorry, it's a primary operator made out of magnet fields of weight. Good. So I'll write it down. C times Tm times Om is what?
So Tm times Om. That is
Tm times Om is
fine. Gives you.
So this is what I wanted in H, right? Jb, which
is.
Okay, so let's put this as Z, let's put this as W. And now this is what?
So this will give you. First H.
Good.
H over Z squared.
Over Z minus W squared. Good.
And okay. Okay. Plus the new by Z minus W.
Wait, what do I put in the new value?
Okay, yeah. What is it? Okay, there will be O and C.
And what, where are they located?
They are at W.
Is C and W or
O? Oh, C and Z and O.
Good. Next,
and now you expand it and get the Z minus Z.
Good. We'll do that. And next step is.
And the next term is C and Z, and then the low at W, and then Z minus Z.
Perfect. Okay. And now, as you say, we tail expand this, then we get a del C, which has a pole, which is H times O. Okay, so it's all that simple. We've done this 100 times. We must start getting used to this. Okay, I could ask you just. Well, okay, we're wasting time, so I won't ask you. Okay, good. So, let's move on. There's one OP that will be of the two major effects.
So the generate the first term.
Yeah, what?
If this also gives the first term, h over z square.
Yeah, exactly. Just gives the whole thing. Does somebody want to do one more OP just for practice? Okay, good after class. Then okay. There are two more facts that will be algebraically useful for us. Okay. First let me write down the last OP that's important.
Oh, the last two OPs that are important. JB and W.
Every operator is at zero.
Minus.
Now I'm not going to try anymore to do any more deriving of these OPs. Okay, let's just take these answers as given and examine them. The only important thing to look at in this OP is the coefficient of the pole. The coefficient of the pole has this term CM, the matter central charge, minus 26. Okay? So that tells you that while classically you can check that the transformation rules that we specify classically squared to zero. Well, classically this is Q is something that squares to zero in any dimension. Quantum mechanically, Q squares to zero only when the matter central charge is 26. So from a BRSD point of view, this is another way of getting the critical dimension straight. Okay? The BRSD current squares to zero and defines the cohomology problem only in the critical. Okay, you'll see as we go on, everything works only in the if one thing fails well, it's no surprise that everything fails. Okay, correct. There's another related statement. Okay? There's another related statement that will be important for us, and that's this. You remember when we started the ghost current, for instance, we found that the bad current was not quite a conserved current. Well, it was in flat space. It was a flat space. But it wasn't quite in curved space because and that was related to the fact that the TJOP didn't have only a 1 by z squared piece, but also had one by z cubed piece. Okay? We had an exercise in which you were supposed to relate this 1 by z cubed piece to the failure of current conservation in an arbitrary curved space. Okay? It's quite a general statement that the only way that a current can be conserved in an arbitrarily curved space is if it's a primary operator. Okay, so this OP here has the CM minus 26 over 2z to the 4th, okay, which would make this non-compound primary operator if it was non-zero, but in the critical dimension it's zero. The remaining part is that of the OP with a primary operator. Okay, so in the critical dimension, J is a primary operator of dimension 1. And therefore is a conserved current on any matter. This will be important for us because we will be when we do string theory on higher genus Riemann surfaces, we will require that we have a conserved ghost current, not just in flat space. Okay, so we've seen two interesting things from the OPs of the ghost current. Firstly, Q squared is equal to zero, though this works only in the critical dimension. Secondly, the ghost current is the primary operator of dimension 1, 0. So this also works on the critical dimension. That's all I want to say about. I think that's all I want to say about the coast guard route. There's one more thing I want to say.
So for JV to be a primary operator, we have to add the term and then also this to be true.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. So the last thing I wanted to say was just an algebraic fact. Maybe I should say two more things. First let's look at this algebraic fact. Okay, we've seen that JB with B has a polar part, which is dm plus dg by z. We also know that the anti-commutator between two fields is related to the residue of the pole. So this statement directly translates into Q BRST anti-commutator B, B0, which is the charge of the B current. Okay? B0 is equal to LM0 plus LG0. Okay? And by appropriately multiplying both sides by z to the appropriate power, it also implies this is anti-commutator. Also implies that QB times BM, let's call it N, is equal to LMN plus LG. Would somebody? Okay, I'm not. I'm tempted to ask somebody to derive this statement for me carefully. Something I wouldn't be tempted to do if I was sure you guys were practicing OPs at home. But I'll leave it for you. When we make statements like this without proof in class, please go and check them. If you have any problem deriving it, please come and ask. Okay? I'll just move on, assuming that you guys are doing all this. But please do it. Okay, then. It's this statement that we will find very useful. Immediately in our discussion. Okay, and finally, is there anything else we want to just say? Yeah. Okay, no. Okay, sounds good. Okay, so that's good. So now the next thing that I wanted questions, comments about anything. Okay, now the next thing I want to do is to move on to a consideration. This whole BRST quantization business. A central element in it is the recovery of the physical spectrum by the construction of BRST cohomology. Okay? So now, in the remainder of this lecture, and may not get over in this lecture, what I want to do is to prove for you that the BRST cohomology on the worksheet of the string is isomorphic to the spectrum we obtained from light cohomization. Okay? This proof, plus certain extensions that we will also explain when we study in more detail the S matrix, okay, has a fancy name. It's called the no host theorem. So, in more detail, I want to prove for you that if you look at the BRST cohomology of the worksheet of the string, you have one-to-one correspondence with the states that we obtained through Lyapunov quantization, not just in number but also in inner product. The last statement is very important because we will have demonstrated through this process that there are no negative norm states on the worksheet of the string. You remember that when we just did Lyapunov quantization, there were negative norm states before we fixed Lyapunov gauge, because there were the oscillators of x0 which were negative norm. Okay? However, when we went to Lyapunov, the only oscillators were in the 24 transverse dimensions. There were no negative norm states. Okay? So what I'm going to prove to you is that you have the same spectrum that you get from Lyapunov quantization, And that the spectrum that we get from BRST quantization is cost-free, in the sense that all the states that that are obtained are states with positive norms. Okay? And it's certainly not true that if we didn't restrict to states that were of the form that were in BRST cohomology, that we would get cost-free states. We'll see negative norm states all over the place as we proceed with our analysis. Okay, so my plan is first to give you the formal argument, and then to demonstrate how it works at the first level of strictness. Okay, so let's start. Let's start by looking at the formal argument, and let's see how far we go. Okay. My discussion of BRST quantization has wholly been mirroring Polchinski's chapter 4. Okay? So anything you don't understand, go and read Polchinski's chapter 4. It's really a beautiful discussion. I've not seen it done better anywhere else. It's very clear. Okay. Good. So let's start. So the first thing that when I say the BRST cohomology of string theory, I mean BRST cohomology plus the additional extra input, that is the analog of the additional extra input that we had for the quantization of the point particle, namely we will also require the B0 one-off states. You see, because in particular, if we just restrict string theory to the zero mode sector, we really recover the quantization of the point particle. Okay? Every oscillator mode gives us a new particle, but the zero mode part is isomorphic to the quantization of the point particle. So just to get the point, to get doubling of the spectrum, we must have eliminate half the modes.
Isomorphism is
string.
This is the
string.
Interactions
or not? No. Yes. This is just the string. As you say. Okay. But just at the level of the quantization, we've been doing it for the spectrum so far. Okay. So, since it worked with the point particle only once we did this, it's clear we must put the same condition here. B0 plays the role of the B operator that we had before. Remember that in string theory also we've got the C0 and B0 that generate the two-state system. Because C0 anti-commutative with B0 is 1. So we've got this two-state system which commutes with the energy operator. So we would have had two states at every level. Now we impose this additional constraint. Okay, so the first thing I do following Polchinski is to define a restricted Hilbert space. I define a restricted Hilbert space in the world sheet of the string as being the state of all operators. Okay, well, let's move it. See, we want psi to obey B0 and psi is equal to 0. But we also want psi to be BRST closed. So it must obey QP on psi. Okay? But therefore it must obey QP times anti-commutative B on psi is equal to 0. But we just computed what QB and the anti-commutative QB would be 0 is. It's the stress tensor theory. It's the L0 theory. In matter and cost. In the matter and cost sector. Okay? Therefore, it must be that L0, where by L0 I mean L0 matter plus L0 cost, okay, on psi is equal to 0. Okay? So, let me do the following. Let me define a restricted Hilbert space H hat to be consist of those states such that B0 on psi is equal to 0. That cuts down the original Hilbert space by half in this two-state system you choose. Okay? And also such that L0 on psi is equal to 0. Okay. Now, this restricted Hilbert space has good action on the BRST operator. Okay? Because the BRST operator maps this Hilbert space to itself. Now I'll check that. We know that QB is at del 0 is equal to what? Summary. BRST operate as a conserved charge, and therefore it works with the Hamiltonian? 0. Okay. And QB times B0 as we've seen is equal to L0. So this commutes when applied to the sector of states that I had any. Okay. So if you act QBRST on a state belonging to H hat, you recover the state. So this QBRST is a good restriction to the subspace agent. Okay? So in all the discussion from now on, we will be restricting our attention to the subspace agent. Okay. Now, in order to perform the discussion, the discussion that we're going to perform now is a little abstract. And it's very clever. But because it's clever, it's the motivation for what we're doing won't be clear until we reach the argument. So you'll have to have until we reach the conclusion, so you'll have to have a little patience. Okay. So the first thing we do is the following. Let's go to the space of oscillators, and let's choose the time oscillator alpha 0 and a particular space direction alpha 1. And let's look at this set of oscillators. Okay. Now we make linear combinations of these oscillators. So we define alpha 0 m plus alpha 1 m and then probably 1 by 2. Plus minus 1 by 2 is it as V alpha plus minus. Okay. The goal is to demonstrate is to find the cohomology of the QBRST operator acting on the inverse space of string theory. Okay?
And then show that it's the same as what?
As Lycoln quantization. Okay? Now, because we want to show that it's the same as Lycoln quantization, well, remember that in Lycoln quantization we chose the time direction and one space direction to be special. Oscillators, no directions were implemented. Okay? So we have to make a special choice. Let's make the same special choice. So this is time, this is space. And we're looking at the oscillators in those special directions, which we want to pick. So what we want to show is that we get that the BRST cohomology is one-to-one correspondence with states obtained by acting only with oscillators in the other directions and no B and C oscillators. Okay? But now there is a preparatory work for this one. Okay. So hang on for a moment before. Okay. Now, the first thing I want to do is to remind you of the commutation relations of these oscillators. Alpha 1 m with alpha 1 minus m was equal to m times delta of m plus n 0. Okay? Which, and the sign here was the statement that the positive n's were annihilation operators, whereas the negative n's were creation operators, and annihilation of creation is positive. Okay? But remember when we did canonical quantization?
M
should equal to minus.
Which is delta
I n 0. But remember the normalization of oscillators was such that.
No, m is equal to minus n.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. Now, but remember that when we did canonical quantization, the commutation relations actually appeared with a G mu U on the right hand side. Okay. So now we're back to working in Minkowski space because we want time to be special. So we write down the same relations here for alpha 0 m and alpha 0 m. We get the same thing with minus 7. Okay. Because canonical commutator and the additional minus sign from the fact of the time component of the metric at minus. Okay, so now let's take these and add them up to see what the commutation relations of alpha plus minus. So let's look at alpha plus with alpha plus. Okay? Suppose we're at an M such that things click. So alpha plus M, alpha plus minus M. We get a plus M from the alpha ones, but a minus M from the alpha zeros, you get Z. Okay? Similarly with alpha minus and alpha minus. So the things that give you something non-zero is alpha plus with alpha minus. Combination relations of these guys are alpha plus M, alpha plus N is equal to alpha minus M, alpha minus N is equal to zero. But alpha, now let me read it out and then we check and explain. Alpha plus M, alpha minus N is minus N. Okay, let's check that out.
In general, alpha mu, alpha mu, we just keep giving that in what there is.
Yeah, we just write that's
that's.
Exactly. That's exactly. That's another better way to say it. Okay, and this minus sign is a sign that there's minus in the matrix. Plus minus quadrants. Okay, great. So now let's consider the following operator. Let's consider the operator sum over M not equal to zero. Okay. One by M alpha plus minus M this operator has a name, it's called HLC. Okay. Now I want to understand what this operator does. Okay, so let's see what this operator does when acting on alpha minus k of, let's say, minus 1 0. Okay? So,
this operator is a number operator.
Yes, it's a number operator that measures the number of negative photons in the minus direction minus the number of photons in the plus direction. Let's take this. Okay, you see, suppose we look at a state with a minus photon. So k is a positive number. Now, if we act with this operator, we get something non-zero. Only if we have alpha plus with a positive. Okay, so n is negative. In that case, we get this commutator which gives us negative number. The numbers cancel, and then we replace it by the same state. You see, we've got an M here that cancels the M here. There were two negatives, so we got a positive. Okay? So, HLC on this, so let's call this psi. HLC on psi is equal to psi. However, suppose we looked at chi, which was equal to alpha minus k of plus 0. Okay, you can convince yourself to get the same thing, but with the opposite sign. Okay, so HLC on chi is equal to minus chi. Okay? And in general, what this operator does is measure the number of minus photons minus the number of plus photons. Okay. Now, actually, this operator is very close to being the boost generator, the generator of boosts on the worksheet of the string. This plays no role in what we're doing, so I won't analyze it in detail, but I recommend you do the following exercise. Compute the Noether charge corresponding to the generator boosts the 1-0 direction on the worksheet of the string, and compare it to this operator. Okay. You find that up to an overall constant, it's exactly this, except for one factor. You see, here we demanded that M was not equal to C. Okay? The generator of the Noether chart that generates boosts to the material plane includes contributions from the zero modes of the string. So it doesn't have this M not equal to C. So apart from the contribution of the zero mode, this is essentially the Lorentz generator for boosts in the world. Okay. Now, so let's move on. Though we don't have much time. Okay, let's move on. Okay. Now the next thing that we want to do is the following. We want to take BRS the operator. Take QB. Okay. So why I introduce this HLC is at the moment totally unclear. It's going to be a formal object that will be useful, will play a useful role. Okay. So now let's take QB and decompose it. It's our meeting, right? Okay.
No, right.
Anyway, there's chocolates in 10 minutes away. Let me just give you we next meet many weeks from now, so I'll probably have to repeat this. But let me just tell you where I'm at. Okay. You can take the Q of BRS, the operator, and decompose it into operators of different HLC number. If you want to try this yourself, check that the three HLC numbers that appear are 0, minus 1, and 1.
Of what?
Take the BRST charge. Okay? So the BRST charge does not have a definite quantum number on the HLC. But you can split it up into a sum of three pieces, each of which does have a definite quantum number on the HLC. Claim that the quantum numbers that appear are 0, minus 1, and 1. The rough intuition is that. The rough intuition is that the BRST charge is Lorentz invariant. Okay, we continue next time. Okay, so let's stop now.